Hello and welcome to the Canadian Museum of History. My name is Caroline Dromaguet and I am Interim President and CEO of the Canadian Museum of History and Director General of the Canadian War Museum. Before I continue, it is important to acknowledge where I'm standing. The Canadian Museum of History is located on the banks of the Ottawa River at the meeting place of three rivers on the traditional unceded territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe. Acknowledging where we are and working closely with Indigenous communities and partners across Canada is vitally important to the museum as we move forward together in a spirit of collaboration and respect. I'm delighted that you've joined us virtually as we open our newest exhibition, Lost Liberties, the War Measures Act. What happens when personal freedoms come into conflict with national security? Developed by the Canadian Museum of History, Lost Liberties explores the crises, fears, and social upheaval that drove the suspension of civil liberties in Canada during the First World War, the Second World War, and the 1970 October Crisis. In each crisis, the federal government invoked the War Measures Act, which suspended the civil liberties of many individuals, groups, and communities in Canada. This exhibition sheds new light on the enduring impact of this legislation on Canada and its people. Lost Liberties examines, notably, the internment of Canadians of Ukrainian origin and other nationalities during the First World War, the internment of Italian Canadians, and the internment and forced relocation of Japanese Canadians during the Second World War, the arrest of hundreds of people in Quebec during the 1970 October Crisis, and the expropriation of Indigenous lands during the First and Second World Wars. The exhibition places these crises within their historical contexts, examines them through multiple perspectives, and features firsthand accounts from the adults and children who lived through them, along with the poignant testimonies of their descendants. Among those most affected by the War Measures Act were Canadian residents whom the federal government associated with enemy countries. One of these groups during the First World War was a Ukrainian-Canadian community whose internment is explored in the exhibition, along with the internment of other groups considered enemy aliens. In 2005, the federal government officially acknowledged that persons of Ukrainian origin were interned in Canada during the First World War. This was followed in 2008 by the establishment of the Canadian First World War Internment Recognition Fund to educate Canadians on this country's first national internment operations, which lasted from 1914 to 1920. The fund's Endowment Council provided a generous grant in support of this exhibition, and we are delighted to have Council Chair Boris Sirski with us today, who will be speaking about the fund in a few minutes. Today's event will also feature an interview with exhibition co-curators Mélanie Morin-Pelletier and Xavier Gélinas, moderated by our Senior Director of Research and Chief Curator Dean Oliver. They will be discussing why this exhibition was developed and why now, as well as how it came together and what visitors can expect to see as they explore the fragility of civil liberties in times of crisis. I would also like to take a moment to acknowledge the 8 members of our External Advisory Committee for their help in developing this exhibition. The committee was composed of experts in the fields of Canadian politics, human rights, immigration, refugees, Indigenous studies, cultural and religious diversity, and political geography. Our sincere thanks to Magali Deleuze, Carl Heal, Lubomir Luchuk, Andrew Parnaby, Roberto Perrin, Laura Madakoro, Paul-Étienne Rainville, May Talismani for their expertise and insights. I would now like to introduce Mr. Sirski, whose remarks will be followed by the video interview on the exhibition.
As chairman of the Canadian First World War Internment Recognition Fund, my council is extremely pleased to support this exhibition, Lost Liberties, the War Measures Act. This exhibition will ensure that visitors to this wonderful Canadian Museum of History will learn of the effects of the war Measures Act and its crippling legacy over 100 years after it was first implemented. We are also delighted that the exhibition contains artifacts from the Morrissey internment camp, unearthed by Dr. Sarah Beaulieu. These artifacts are historical proof that these tragic events actually happened. Congratulations to one of the finest museums in Canada, the Canadian Museum of History, for conveying this story, which focuses on some of the dark chapters in Canadian history. We are hopeful that, with education, this infringement on Canadian civil liberties will never happen again.
My name is Dean Oliver, and I'm the Director of Research for the Canadian Museum of History. I'm talking today with Dr. Xavier Gélinas and Dr. Mélanie Morin-Pelletier about their work curating this unique exhibition. Dr. Gélinas is the Museum of History's Curator of Political History, while Dr. Morin-Pelletier is the historian, war and society at the Canadian War Museum. Xavier and Mélanie will be providing us with some insights and a glimpse behind the scenes on their experience of developing this unique exhibition. Mélanie and Xavier, welcome. As museologists, what are some of the challenges or opportunities you encountered in mounting this exhibition?
As you can imagine, we have been working on this exhibition project for over 3 years. So the challenges have been quite numerous, but they have been, you know, met with a spirit of resolve. And one thing that really struck me throughout these 3 years was how to resolve or how to find the balance between the fact that we are dealing with one main topic, the War Measures Act, a topic which is actively present throughout the exhibition. The War Measures Act is the lightning or the switch or the ignition that starts everything that we talk about. And yet, the exhibition addresses three extremely different historical periods. So we wanted to ensure that visitors would not be confused. Yes, there is one common factor reuniting or gluing all these time periods together, but of course the time periods are extremely distinct. And we worked to resolve this mainly through the help of design, very creative design, I think. I can extol the virtues of it because I'm not the designer. So the First World War section really has an unmistakable First World War look. The visitors make no confusion. They know they are between 1914 and the following years, and certainly not in the 1940s, nor in 1970. And after the First World War section, there is a very clear corridor called, in our jargon, transition, positioning the visitor to leap from the 1919-1920 period to 1939. To make extremely clear that although we have the War Measures Act as the common agent, we really go from time period to time period. And the same process occurs between the Second World War and the October 1970 crisis. We make a leap of 25 years, but through the creative assistance of design, we hope that it's very clear for the visitor that we respect the autonomy of each period while having a common factor throughout.
From the beginning of the project, it was very important for us to give the voice to the individuals who lived through these events and to their descendants. So dozens of individuals from communities affected by the War Measures Act were consulted, including Ukrainian Canadians, Italian Canadians, Japanese Canadians, and many other groups. They generously, courageously told us their stories and explained why it was important to share their stories. Their stories are in the center of this exhibition. We tell these stories through artifacts, through videos, through their quotations. And we really hope that the visitors will understand what they went through as individuals, as families, as communities, but also that the tragic legacy of these stories go way beyond the times of crisis.
Why is it important for museums to address subjects of such controversy and lingering impact?
It is very important. For decades, there was a will to cover up, to bury these stories. Internment camps were destroyed. In the 1950s, most of the public archives on internment were also destroyed. Members of the Ukrainian-Canadian community were told that this had never happened. So in the exhibition, we meet many individuals whose lives were changed forever, even destroyed by internment, by forced relocation, by incarceration. And the trauma associated with these events is being passed on from one generation to another. So I do believe that as a national institution, it is a big part of our duty to shed light on these events, to educate, and also to help visitors or invite visitors to reflect on these issues that are still very relevant today.
Yes, I also think that national museums do have a social and educational mandate. We are here for many purposes. It's very good that we show beautiful aesthetic things and interesting stories and sometimes amusing stories. That's all part of our mandate. But the social and educational aspect, including the thorny, difficult, sensitive, problematic topics, that's part of our mission. And I think if we are up to it, we can present some thoughts, ideas, and events to the public in as balanced a way as possible to help contribute to a public discussion and consideration of events. The museum, of course, doesn't take editorial stance. That's not our purpose, our mission. Our purpose is to gather and make sense of existing information, ideas, stories, objects, and images, and present them to the public and contribute to a public conversation. For instance, the exhibition ends with a very contemporary reflection of the COVID-19 crisis, and a reflection which, of course, we would never have envisioned when we started the project, many years ago. Because in a certain sense, the current debate that we have been having across the world between the preservation of public health and public order on the one hand, and the preservation of individual rights and liberties and freedoms on the other hand, this difficult, complicated balance shows that the events that we are covering in this exhibition are, of course, something of the past. But the same questioning, the same balance between individual liberties and public order and public crisis, the same questioning remains with us.
Is there a story or object in this exhibition that you found particularly impactful or evocative?
I would say as a museum curator, it's very hard to choose one or more poignant stories about the many that we are covering. So if you will allow me, I'd like to answer by a sidestep. I won't choose one story of one individual or family in particular, but I would like to take the angle of a witness. We are showing at the end of the October crisis section a very wide-sized painting by a deceased artist from Ontario called Dennis Torben. Dennis Torben was a very young man when the October crisis of 1970 occurred. He wasn't involved at all. He was from St. Catharines and only saw these events through the media. So he had no personal involvement or political involvement. Nevertheless, he grew increasingly haunted by what he learned bits by bits of the October crisis when growing up and becoming an accomplished artist in the 1970s, 1980s, and early 1990s, to the point that he produced a great number of oeuvres of great dimensions, drawings and paintings, showing the impact of the October crisis. And I think this oeuvre or this painting that we are showing, with its very stark colors, shows that the October crisis was really a trauma for the actual victims of the kidnappings, for the people who were condemned to jail or searches with sometimes dubious motive, and for public opinion. And innocence was lost, and the painting by Turbin, I think, wants to convey that the age of Canadian innocence really ceased in October 1970.
For me, one of the most moving stories happened in the Second World War section, where we explored the experiences of more than 21,000 Japanese Canadians who were forcibly relocated. In this section, we feature four individuals who were children at the time, including Mary Murakami Kitagawa. Madame Kitagawa graciously, generously loaned us the geta, so Japanese sandals that her father made while they were in the camp. And in April 1942, the family's home, their farm, most of their belongings were seized and sold by the government. So for the next 5 years, they were forcibly relocated. And it means that her parents had to do whatever they could to provide for their children, including making shoes for them. So to me, these little sandals represent the courage, the perseverance, the resilience of all the individuals, all the families, and all the communities who went through these very difficult times.
Thank you, Mélanie. Thank you, Xavier. On behalf of the museum and my colleagues, thank you for joining us. We hope to see you again soon.
Thank you, Mélanie, Xavier, and Dean, for the fascinating inside look at the exhibition. Thank you, Mr. Sirski. The museum has developed an online educational package for Lost Liberties aimed at high school teachers and students exploring the First and Second World Wars, the October Crisis, and law and politics in Canada. It can be accessed through the Teacher Zone on the museum's website. I would like to take this opportunity to thank the individuals who contributed compelling testimonies to this exhibition and to the private donors and institutions who lent rare artifacts that speak powerfully to those important events. Exploring such pivotal events through the voices and experiences of those who lived through them and their descendants not only gives us new perspectives on our shared history, but a better understanding of this country today. Lost Liberties, the War Measures Act, opens December 17, 2021. For more on the exhibition, time ticketing, and current health and safety protocols, please visit the museum's website. Thank you for joining us this afternoon for our virtual opening of Lost Liberties. We hope to see you in person at the museum soon.